full of the wolves. But that night could have, that same three-quarter inch knife could have made the wider wound. But the knife that made the deeper wounds could not have been any more than 3/4 of an inch wide. So there is open the possibility that it is two different blades, but it is possible that it, that all of these wounds, every single wound on this body was made by one knife that was 3/4 inches wide.
Right. I agree. And that was exactly her testimony.
Okay. Well, she did good about that.
Yeah, she was actually did a very good job in the trial of not overstating any opinions. You know, she said, she was asked, could it be that there was just one knife? And she was careful to say, if there was only one knife, then it would have had to have been a maximum width of 3/4 of an inch.
Okay. So it's important to know that knife wounds, even if fatal, and gun wounds, even if fatal, don't kill right away.
Right.
There are people who've been fatally shot a number of times who still move and attack or run away. Adrenaline is an amazing thing, and other drugs can also drive people. You know, I'm talking about illegal drugs, but also hormones and so forth that are secreted in your body can also drive you past what should have killed you. So the fact that she has a number of fatal wounds does not mean that she either died or even stopped fighting when she received those wounds. To me, I would say that she was very brave. She did not give up. It was an attack of a non-compliant victim, and it indicates this attack and the stab wounds and their locations and the variety of them and the variety of angles and depths tells me that it has the sort of imprint of an offender that failed to control his victim. In other words, one of the things that we have learned in the behavioral analysis unit about human behavior is that people can be extremely well controlled by a knife blade. People are actually more likely to be controlled by a knife blade than they are by a gun. And that goes to the fact that most people have had an experience in their lives where they were cut by a knife. They know what that feels like. They know that it slices right through the skin. They know how dangerous that can be. And they fear that. It's a visceral fear. And yet, a gun that can potentially do more damage, people don't typically have an experience level with a gun. Most people have not been shot, and so they don't know what it actually feels like. And so the reaction is not as visceral. This person was unable to control this victim with a knife, with a threat of a knife. And I don't see a lot of what would indicate to me that this person sort of came up from behind and stuck a knife at their throat to try to control them. There's no scratches on the neck. There's no knife wounds on the neck. There is the one wound across the face. But that could very well be that offender was coming down with the knife and the victim deflected the knife or deflected herself so that the knife ended up cutting her there. There's no indication to me that this person had control of this victim at any time. I think this was dynamic the entire interaction. And I think that when finally the victim was down on the ground, that the stab wounds to the chest, number 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 6, were done in that sort of dynamic way. And I think if you look at those, stab wound 2, the sharp ends of the blade point sort of in an upward direction to the left. Stab wound 3, sharp end of the blade points in an upward direction to the right. Stab wound 4, again to the left. Stab wound 5, again to the right. And then stab wound 6 is rotated even further down to the right. I think those things happened at two different times in this incident. Unless the victim was fighting so badly that it caused the offender to literally rotate the knife in his or her hand during this attack, which seems kind of unreasonable, I don't see how those could have happened all at the same time. What did you think when you looked at that?
Oh, I agree completely. I had kind of, by my assessment, clustered a couple of the wounds together And that was stab wound number one and stab wound number four. And I think one and four together and then five and six together, as though it, and that was assuming if you have a right-handed person coming from behind, reaching around, that they're reaching over and stabbing and hitting the chest and then hitting lower on the chest and then come back and come under the arm to create wounds number six and five, that they could have happened at one time. But I don't see how stab wound number three fits with any of them.
Well, to me, stab wound five and three look like they're have the same directionality. And I agree with you that, that two and four also do, but I think three and five work the same. For example, if the offender, with respect to this victim, as you see it in the diagram, if the offender was on the victim's right-hand side, let's say the victim's on the ground now, and the offender would be by, you know, let's say kneeling by the victim's elbow, right elbow,
mm-hmm.
then those stab wounds from a right-handed person could have been driven in right there.
And for me, I was looking at, I was trying to, you know, it's so difficult to take all the elements together. I was looking at, you know, the orientation of the blade and along with the directionality of the stab is kind of where I had come up because the, at first I had marked, you know, the orientation was different. So it came from a different place. And then I kind of ran some experiments and pretended to stab Mike several times in the studio, which he appreciated. It was like, it actually almost seemed natural if you hit two stabs over the shoulder and then swung your arm around from underneath, like underneath the arm for the following two, that they could end up oriented that way if it was that dynamic.
I'm just not sure that you're going to get that much penetration out of a stab wound that's general, that you're basically saying you think that the offender was behind and pulling the knife towards himself into her body.
Right, or at least that's a theory.
Yeah, well, I don't know if that's the case, but I think that the depth of these wounds, up to the depth of 4.5 inches, I believe, that I think that her back was probably on the ground at this point. But, you know, I'm not totally discounting what your theory is. I'm just saying it seems like the most common way to dispatch somebody, if that's what you're trying to do and you're behind them, is to simply take the knife and draw it across their throat. And that's it. I mean, why go through the stabbing motion of, you know, bringing the knife back towards you? It seems a little, one, dangerous, I guess, unless you know that that person's body is more than 4.5 inches and your knife is only 4.5 inches. But it just seems like a much more difficult thing to do than literally just taking the knife and slicing their throat. But anyway, that be that as it may, I think if you look at these stab wounds in the clusters that you're talking about, I do believe that you can get a change in directionality based on the twisting of the body. I mean, I don't think she's dead.
So right.
I don't think she's incapacitated, and I don't think she's being pinned to the ground still. So it's just her position relative to his position. I'm just going to say the victim's position relative to the killer's position has changed, but that doesn't mean that he has actually moved physically. In other words, he draws his hand back and she curls into a ball, twists her body to the right. You know, that changes the directionality completely. So you have to just think not in terms of the static way that the body's being diagrammed, but the dynamic way in which people can move with respect to each other. Again, the fact that there doesn't seem to be enough of any kind of contusion on the head to indicate that she was knocked unconscious. There's no brain bleed. There's no indicators that she was immobile. So I would think that what you're seeing more likely is because she is moving as the knife is going in and out and in again. She's moving in between those strikes.
That makes a lot of sense. And also what you had said about, you know, I hadn't thought about why reach around and make multiple stab wounds if you're behind them when you could, like you said, slit her throat or just drive the knife through her back. So I think your hypothesis on this is probably a lot closer than my original one was.
Well, I don't know for sure. Obviously, there's still a lot of questions. But like, for example, if you look at stab wound number two baboon number four, the orientation of the knife and the angle appears to be the same. In this case, it appears to be that either the fender was, with respect to her, let's say she's on the ground, would have been kneeling above her shoulder near her head with the knife blade pointing towards the offender and a downward stroke is made, right?
Right.
But her body was probably lifted a little onto her left shoulder so that the angle of entry from the perpendicular looks like it's from front to back and top to bottom. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, that makes perfect sense.
That could all be done with her rolling over to her left side, curling up maybe.
Trying to get away from him.
Right. But then if you look at stab wound number six, that's not the case at all. Because now the knife point is oriented 180 degrees in the opposite direction. And so, A, it could mean that he stabs her. Stab number four is the first one from that position. Stab number two is the second one from that position. He hits her sternum in that. It knocks the knife out of his hand. He picks it up, and now the blade's in the other direction, and he stabs her down in the abdomen. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, that makes
sense. All three of those directionally come from the same direction. So he hit. He got one deep stab wound in the middle of her chest. He stabbed her again at the top of her chest, but hit the sternum, and the knife fell out of his hand or loosened out of his hand. He re-grabs it, but the blade is going in the other direction, and he reaches down to a softer area because he failed in the upper chest area, and now he stabs her towards the abdomen. So that makes all three of those, stab wound two, stab wound four, and stab wound six, all within the same short period of time.
Yeah, those are actually, I have in my original markup here, I have those three clustered together.
Okay. The unique factor is that two of them, the sharp part of the blade is oriented one way, and the third one, it's oriented the other way. So I'm trying to figure out how does that happen.
And right.
One of them, we know, very shallow because it hit her sternum, and therefore that might have knocked it out of his hand. He may have even gotten cut at that point because his hand slipped down on the blade, and it turned around for the next one when he grabbed it and put it back into her. So, again, I think those most likely happened seconds. In other words, I don't believe that happened in the beginning, in the initial stages of this attack. I believe that there are stab wounds on her back that preceded that. And I do believe that she might have been flipping back and forth. And the indicators of the directionality, like if we now go to back diagram, you'll see that stab wounds 8, 9, and 10 all have a directionality from her left side to her right side.
Right.
And if we go back to the previous ones, remember, it looked like he was at her right shoulder, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you now look this way, if he was at her right shoulder, that doesn't make sense, right?
Right.
The ones that make sense then are the ones that are numbered 7 and 11. That makes sense.
Right.
Right? So the ones that are 8, 9, and 10 were most likely made when the stabber was by her left shoulder. So A, that can mean there's two different stabbers here. Or B, it can mean that these are two different incidents. In other words, she broke away, something interrupted, she fought him off, and then he got her again.
Right. Do you find there's any possibility of indication of handedness here, where we have the three wounds that go left to right, and then the two wounds that go right to left on the back?
Well, again, if we could definitively say that they were different weapons, then I think that would be relevant. I think that since we're talking about only one of these wounds is 3/4 of an inch, the other ones are all greater than that. That could be the movement of the body while the stabbing is happening. But they're generally centered, and I would say that it's just very difficult to say. I would say that that it's possible for the ones that are labeled 7 and 11 to have been done by a right-handed person who was stabbing with the blade facing them. stabbing downward at a position near her right shoulder.